tonight's show, we're going to be talking all about asthma and allergies. We're approaching cold and flu season. We're approaching that seasonal change. And so allergies and asthma are a big, big part of what we're going to see increase. Now, many of you also might be curious or wondering about that cold and flu season, and there may be some overlap with COVID. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that too, whether or not you should be concerned. So let's dive in. We're going to, again, talk about allergies, the immune system, and asthma. So let's just talk a little bit about some asthma facts here. Number one, we've got 25 million. Now, these are U.S. numbers. So if you're tuning in from somewhere else in the world, you know, your numbers might vary from country to country. These are in the United States. But 25 million people in the U.S. suffer from asthma, which results in, check this out, 10 million annual visits to the doctor's office. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of resources being used up for this, right? We've got symptoms of asthma. You know, most people know coughing, wheezing, tightening of the chest, fatigue, anxiousness. Sometimes this one is not talked about, that anxiousness. So if you struggle with anxiety or being anxious a lot, it could be because your airways are inflamed and you're getting reduced oxygen. Reduced oxygen can happen for a number of different reasons. But in asthma, obviously, you're not getting adequate oxygen into the lung fields. But some people also have it with different kinds of anemias. And that's why I bring it up, because if you're gluten sensitive or if you have an issue with gluten, this is a very common cause of iron deficiency anemia. And so that also leads to the symptom here, okay, of anxiousness or anxiety, and then difficulty talking as well. So these are, again, some of your more common symptoms of asthma. We've got 1.6 million trips to the emergency room out of these $10 million annual doctor's visits. And then again, a total cost of $56 billion annually. And then we've got this big one right here. So the incidence, this is big because the numbers are climbing dramatically. The incidence is rapidly increasing. Just in the past 5 years or so, the cases of asthma have gone they've gone up by about 5 million. So from 20 million to 25 million just in the past few years, we see that increase. We also know this. So why do we see that increase over the past few years? There's a lot of speculation. There's a lot of reasons why. We're going to talk and get into some of those reasons. But this is a big one right here. We see there's a corollary curve between obesity, the rise in obesity, as well as the rise in asthma. And we know at this point, it's approximately 45% of the U.S. population is obese. And more than half, almost actually, I think it's the last numbers, were 60% of the population is overweight. Now, the difference between being overweight and obese is more weight, right? But obesity is even more dangerous. So it increases the risk for the development of asthma. The two go hand in hand. So, and when I say asthma, let me back up just a minute. What I also want you to be thinking about here, because people don't realize, is asthma is an immune response. And so when we're talking about seasonal allergies, food allergies, those types of things, this is an immune response that creates an inflammatory issue in the airway. And there are different mechanisms behind that immune response. But if you're developing asthma and your doctor hasn't really looked at you and what you might be reactive to, whether it be food allergies or whether it be food sensitivities or whether it be outdoor environmental allergens, things of that nature that you might be able to filter, it's a big, big key component. Because, and here's why, if you have asthma, okay, then you're using your immune system and you're weakening your immune system. You're using your immune system for the lungs, but you're weakening your immune system to fight everything else. And what that does is that it puts you at an increased risk for infection. It puts you at an increased risk for more aggressive seasonal allergies. So increased risk for bacterial, viral, et cetera, infections, but also an increased risk for allergy response. And this is why it's important to connect the two. Allergies and asthma go hand in hand because they're both intrinsically related with your immune system. So let's talk about some of the common triggers of asthma. So I want to take you kind of through a journey, a lifestyle journey here. So one of the first things that happens to people, if your children were born in a hospital, a lot of times, and a lot of doctors are doing this nowadays, they're doing these cesarean, these scheduled cesareans, where, you know, the wife and the husband get with the OB/GYN, get with the doc, and they schedule the birthday of the baby. In essence, it's planned. That cesarean is planned. And so the problem with a cesarean birth, and I'm not saying if you've had a cesarean birth that you're a bad or an evil person, so don't take this the wrong way. But a cesarean birth reduces the initial exposure to the vaginal flora. So remember that the baby is exposed to flora through the vaginal canal. So if we bypass the vaginal canal, the baby's first exposure to flora is the hospital air. Now, what's the problem with hospital air? The problem with hospital air is it's full of what are called nosocomial bacteria. These are antibiotic resistant bacteria that have been shown, there've been a number of research studies showing that cesarean babies are more prone to allergies and asthma as a result of lacking the vaginal flora exposure upon birth. Now, there's something that you can talk with your doctor about. There's actually a type of therapy that can be done, and that's where they take a cloth and they absorb the vaginal membrane and juices and things, and they swab the baby's face. So they're calling that vaginal swabbing. So they swab the inside of the mouth and the face after the baby comes out cesarean, and that way they're colonizing the baby with the microflora from the mother's vaginal fluids and liquids. And that helps to set the stage for a healthy microbiome. Now think about this. We talk about autoimmune disease all the time. We talk about one of the primary or predominant triggers for autoimmunity. And remember, asthma is an autoimmune problem. But one of the primary drivers or triggers is a leaky gut. So if we're giving birth to children who aren't getting exposure to healthy microbiomes, then they don't initially get great colonization, right? And that's important for their immune function, for their immune system to develop. So we want the babies, okay, to get that exposure. So if you have an emergency C-section, or, you know, this is part of childhood planning, when you're talking to your doctor, when you're talking to your husband or wife, this is part of what you want to plan for. If a C-section has to happen in an emergency scenario, vaginal swabbing can be something that can be very, very helpful for your baby. So talk about it ahead of time in case it has to happen. But if you're having a vaginal birth, you don't have to worry about this. Another one is lack of breastfeeding. So again, we look at stage one here, right? Stage one, babies are born with a disadvantage of getting flora. Stage two, lack of breastfeeding. Now, many women are choosing to breastfeed more and more and more, but a lot don't. A lot of women work. They've got to go to work. Now, again, this is not me saying if you didn't breastfeed your child that you're a terrible parent. I just want to educate you, and I want you to understand how important this is. A lot of your formulas, the primary ingredient is high fructose corn syrup or sugar, right? So when you're talking about feeding your baby, and I want you to all do me a favor. Any of you who know a mom, who know new parents, right? Make them read the back of the label of the formula, the ingredients. And what you're going to find, usually the second or third ingredient, is corn syrup, right? It's one of the predominant ingredients today, or sugar of another variety. But corn syrup is the most common one used with most formulas. So basically what you're getting, genetically modified corn syrup extraction with synthetic vitamins and some protein added in. This is what many, many formulas are made out of. They make them super sweet. So you're basically feeding your baby sugar water with protein and synthetic vitamins as a primary substrate of fuel, as their primary source in the diet. It's terrible, right? We don't want to start babies off with pure fructose corn syrup as something that's supposed to nourish them. So again, we know that sugar plays a role in inciting inflammation. And what are we talking about here? We're talking about airway inflammation. That's what asthma is. It's a form of autoimmune induced airway inflammation. So we don't want cesarean. If you have to have a cesarean, vaginal swabbing. Number two, if you're not going to breastfeed your child, really proofread those formulas and make sure you pick the absolute best one. There's some companies coming out with newer formulas that don't contain all this corn syrup and GMO based ingredients, and that would be a good idea to investigate. But if you're buying kind of your standard run-of-the-mill formulas in the grocery store, you're basically feeding your baby sugar water with synthetic proteins and vitamins in it. And that's not good. Number three, as life goes on, so baby's born cesarean, then if it's they're not breastfed, they're fed sugar water, right, for 2 or 3 years. And then they're introduced to the plethora of processed foods, the dyes, the artificial flavors, the food additives, the pesticides, preservatives. All of these things we know can burden the immune system. It's not that maybe any one of these things completely destroys a person's health, but it's the conglomeration of the multitudes, the thousands of different chemical processing agents that are found in all these processed foods that we're rearing our children on. So our children, again, cesarean birth, poor feeding if we're not breastfeeding, and then when we introduce them to food, the foods are so highly processed to contain up to, there's, I think at last check, there was approximately 3,000 different forms of chemicals found in processed food that the government approves and basically tells you there's no harm or that they're safe. Not true. We know that there's, in biochemistry, there's something called the law of synergism. That is when you add multiple chemicals together, then they can have a synergistic impact or synergistic effect. Kind of like, I don't know if you guys remember this, but it was maybe 15, 20 years ago, college athletes and high school football players were popping aspirin and they were mixing it with caffeine and ephedra. And so this triple combination of three basically drugs that are stimulants, when you add all three together, it's not 1 + 1 + 1, it's 1 × 10 × 10. And so the effect was far greater. And so some athletes were pushing their hearts so hard and then going out on the football field, and several people died because that was a popular supplement stack. So that synergistic effect of multiple chemicals working together. Well, remember, with processed food, we have up to 10 or up to 3,000 different foods that are working together. So no safety data on all of these chemical complexes being added together. Hey, don't forget to check out the rest of the series right here. Make sure you hit subscribe below. And as always, thanks for tuning in.